Welcome to Italian Innovators. Today, I'm in the company of Luca Vullo, actor, director, performer, author, speaker, and communication coach. With him, we will talk today about gestures and nonverbal communication as a distinctive anthropological element of Italian culture, as a transnational language, and as an effective tool of team building, value creation, and empathic delivery. Starting from his theatrical show focused on the Sicilian repertoire of gestures, Luca explored the human body as the epicenter of communication and an original voice of its own. From theater to cinema, from documentaries to communication, from branding to university workshops, Luca really created around gestures an innovative space of research, reframing the Italian natural expressivity into a tool for successful business. We'll talk about your work during our conversation, so I don't spend too much time here. But for now, let me thank you from the heart for being with us today. It's really a great pleasure to have you in the show.
Hi, Luca. Thank you so much for this amazing presentation. please continue. it's amazing to hear, right? Thank you.
Definitely. And I was anticipating, today we'll explore your path from Sicily to the world. Yeah. And we'll see how you created a job, how you found your position, your niche, and we'll discuss gestures as a non-written code carrying an emotional intelligence and a hidden grammar. We'll also see how gestures become in your work a polyvalent and multidisciplinary platform connecting theater, communication, and education. Now, I want to start from your story, from Caltanissetta, Sicily, to the world.
Yeah, rock and roll, man. Caltanissetta from Sicily, yeah, center of east of the island, right?
Absolutely. Now, in talking about yourself, you said once that you don't have dreams, you live your dreams.
Yeah.
How did you discover your path?
When I tell that I live my dreams, I mean that I live what I really want in my life. I'm doing what I want with all my passion, with all my determination, even if I don't achieve the goal at the end. But the path is exactly this this way, this part of the trip. I love to go there. I love this objective, this aim of my life, and I need to go there. Even if it's so difficult, so hard to achieve it, is I need it. And this is the part of my dream, because it's beautiful, this traveling around. And of course, I totally believe in my projects and my ideas, and I can't stop myself to continue this kind of multitasking work. You said before, like, it's really multi-layers. It's true. But the idea started in my town, Caltanissetta in Sicily, when I thought, what I can tell abroad about Italy, about excellence of Italians, because we are very known, well known around the world for many things, for food, for fashion, for whatever, everything. We are excellent in many things, even mafia maybe, but unfortunately, but there is another aspect very important of our culture, that is communication, non-verbal communication. We are the most skilled people around the world to use the body to be connected with people. And I think it's a very talent that we have, and never before me, no one before me started to teach it in universities. And was my idea, is possible to teach Italian gestures at the university? Yes, it's possible. Yeah. And after my movie called with the same name of the show, The Voice of the Body, after this movie, I moved in London, and there started my really transformation of the idea, right? Because apart the movie that was about Sicilian gestures specifically, because of course in the South Italy is more authentic and more, is it too much more of Italian in the north? And of course, but there is a reason, of course, there are a lot of reasons, historical reasons, but also our natural attitude to use the body, and our natural attitude in theater. We are very theatrical. And when I arrived the first time in London, I realized that they use very bad body to communicate. I was thinking, oh my God. Okay, I don't speak very well English. Maybe my English is so poor. Perfect. But I can teach them to use better the body language. And they started to understand how important was this matter for their life in the professional side and the personal side. And after my first screenings around the Italian Cultural Institute or Italian associations, I started to teach with my job to the students at the universities in London before and after Cambridge, after around the world. But was just in the beginning was just a joke, because I thought probably they don't want to have me like a teacher in the body language, because it's okay, it's so strange. But to understand Italy and Italians, you must study Italian gestures. That's my point, was my point. And they realized it was true. It's true. To understand our mentality, our way of life, our way of communicate, you must study Italian gestures. That's why I'm here.
Definitely. You also described the path of an entrepreneur who does not necessarily have a path already created. It's just like by walking that someone discovers a path and finds out actually the relevance of the niche or the positioning where one placed himself or herself. Now, I want to go back to what you were saying about the Italian ability to speak with the body and speak with gestures. Yeah. And I want to underline something that relates to the relevance of gestures for Italians, as both really a transcultural language, which allows Italians to communicate with, allowed over time to communicate with the different occupiers of the peninsula, and yeah, also gestures as a secret code, which, as you describe in your TED talk in Varese, my city, really allows Italian to communicate without being understood. Now, you indicate that this natural ability to communicate to anyone is a distinctive element of Italian culture. But why is this expressiveness, communicativeness, or as you call it, the language of the body, a key feature of the Italian flair? Like, why are people attracted to it?
Of course, all people around the world think that Italians are too much in communication, and they think it's a sort of stereotype, but they love it. The point is, they love it. They love this wave or transfer emotions, passion, and thoughts in clearly mode. Then you immediately understand if an Italian is happy or angry or whatever is feeling. And I mean, this is a power. It's a power in human relations. You can communicate in the best way if you understand the emotions of the other person, and if the person is prepared in emotional intelligence too. And I think in Italy, we have this kind of approach with emotions. We speak about emotions a lot. We have this kind of communication in deep when we meet each other. We start to talk about everything, about our intimacy too. And you know better than me, in America, in the US, in other countries, it's not a good idea to speak about your emotions because you are vulnerable. And it doesn't work very well for your personal protection, I mean, your private space. And for us, I never realized before London what was my private space. I never heard about that, you know?
Because social life, the Italian life.
Exactly. That's why you call it piazza, the piazza, the square. Like, we are always around in a square talking with people and fluently, right? And that's why I think it's so important to understand that this kind of communication open windows in all people around me. That's why after my show with my mom around the world, in Vietnam, in Norway, in America, wherever, the people start to hug my mom after the show. They wait my mom to hug her, you know, because they need it. Mommy, mommy, the big mama Italiana from the South Italy, they need it. And for me, this is the best answer I can tell.
Definitely. And this is also, you use the word power, what makes an object, a product or a communication appealing, desirable, yeah. Which is one of the key features of a commercial product, of any interaction in a way, the ability to be persuasive.
Right.
And also in a delivery, in an academic delivery, I think this would be very much needed.
Yeah, now, and it's a sort of superpower, you know what I mean? I call it superpower.
Definitely, <That's>... super distinctive, and it's what like makes a thing acquire its gusto, its flair.
Right.
Like flair comes from flagrare in Latin, which means to burn. It makes a thing burning, like hot. And this is really important.
Yeah.
Now I want to bring you back to some philosophy here. Now Nietzsche was really the first to retrieve the centrality of the body. He calls it like our great reason after really centuries of mind-body dualism. What you do is that you shed light in your books and in your creative work on the grammar of the body, or rather the set of meanings that each gesture carries. And actually the word gesture comes from the Latin gerere, to carry. So what does a gesture carry beyond its mere translation? So you always do a lot of translation of gestures, but what is there beyond this? And then as a coach also, who led many workshops on the theme for many companies or universities, so why are gestures fundamental expressions of an emotional intelligence? And why is this paramount to developing brand communication and team building?
I started usually to work with companies around the world because they realized that I was working in something very special. Italian gestures, the comparison with other cultures, with other gestures of other people, is so interesting to understand intercultural issues that we can have when we meet each other, when we work in the same company, but we are a German and Italian and Japanese. And of course, like, we have a lot of misunderstanding in communication, of verbal communication, but even in nonverbal communication. And you think sometimes a lot of issues in the companies are about this. And human resource people called me like, Luca, please help us, because they don't understand. It's cultural. It's not just because he's creepy or he's a bad person. It's just German, Italian, Spain, and different cultures. And of course, they act in a different way. And even if they stay in the same office every day. And for me, this key was important to tell. Oh, of course, I went around the world for 10 years meeting like people from all over the world and discussing about my nonverbal communication and your nonverbal communication. Then I understand Americans, Japanese, French, Spain, and people from the North Europe, from Africa, from all over the world. And now I can talk about that. I can help people to stay together, to understand together in the super layer, up their cultures, you know, just body language communication to be empathic and understanding each other in a good way without judge. Because, you know, the judge is the worst thing usually when we work together in the teamwork, you know? And That's why nonverbal communication of go inside is not just public speaking or, you know what I mean? I don't do this kind of, okay, I help people even in this, to use the body language in the best way, the voice, the presence, whatever. But this is just a part of the work. What I put inside is exactly the plus of emotional way. Okay, how important is emotional intelligence that you know better than me, that is born in America, no? Daniel Goleman, all the teams and whatever. But I really believe in that. It's just to demonstrate that my company, my cinematographic company is called Onde Motive in Italian, is emotional waves, mm-hmm. the translation, you know, because I totally believe in this. Then my team building and my coaching are always in those two, you know, layers. Communication through the body, use your body in the best way to connect with people. And of course, with the best use of emotional intelligence, because they're connected. It's a perfect marriage. You can stay without one, right?
Yeah, and also as an actor in theater, there is a plus value. It just really allows an idea to become an event.
Yeah, but I want to tell you something, Luca. I never studied acting. My performing art is coming out after my teaching at the universities, after my workshop, because the students start to say to me, Luca, you are fantastic. Why you don't prepare a sort of show or stand-up comedy, something like that? And I started properly in the US 5 years ago, 6 years ago. I started to try, like in the pizzeria, Italiana mm-hmm. pizzeria in San Francisco or whatever. Like I started like, let's try in San Diego. And I started, the people are laughing. The people, it's working. They understand me. And of course they like it. They like the subject because they recognize it. And after, it's not just, you know, funny. Mm-hmm. I'm not talking about just language or communication. Emotion, then human being. That's the point. That's why at the end the people are touched, you know, because they said, okay, it's funny, interesting, but also I'm thinking a lot about that. You know what I mean? I think this is the key of my work.
Yeah, in a sense, like the interesting part is really how to transform that power or that magic that you were describing earlier or now into a value.
Exactly.
And this is really
a lot of value inside, right?
Yeah, the ability of theater and every good teacher in a way is an actor. There's a lot of theater in teaching how to transform a little piece in a classroom into a value that Marx assigned in insegnare into
exactly
another person.
Luca, yeah. But my last book that I wrote right now is called in Italian Il corpo è docente. The body is teaching, in of course is specifically is directed to teachers at the school, because in front of students, in front of people that are listening to you and to ready to learn something, you must be a good communicator. You can know everything, whatever you want. You can be the best, you know, your best knowledge in the world. But if you can't communicate in the right way, it's nothing.
Yeah, you can't connect.
No, it's just relevant for you, yeah. And they don't, you know, absorb nothing, right?
No, definitely. And you also, in talking about theater, you also hinted earlier at the melodramatic context of Italian society, which is heavily influenced by opera and by theater and by this exactly. theatrical social nature. And certainly in your work, you tap into this repertoire, into this depository of tradition. But like, I want to ask you, like, when it comes to a 2-minute ad or social media, mm-hmm. how do you translate this idea of the event or the connection or the theatricality that the gesture generates onto a different platform than the stage? How does the grammar of gesture become a visual strategy?
It's very difficult because honestly, I never decide to put online my, for instance, my lessons, because I think what I'm doing is very cultural, and I mean, it's not just a joke. And online, you can find a lot of people that are joking with the Italian gestures, but in a funny way, and of course, they play with the stereotypes, and is another film. Okay. Mm-hmm. Personally, I think that what I'm doing with University of Bocconi or around the world, many universities in the U.S. is a very specific coaching in Italian gestures that is difficult to translate in small clips, just to give you something, some taste, you know what I mean? Or to reply my gesture to be able to use the body language. It's just another side of the game. Personally, what I can do and what I do usually with the social network is to catch people with a subject, you know? Do you like nonverbal communication? How you use nonverbal communication in your work? And after that, we start the discussion. Because I think is that the analysis after the question, they start the real, contribution of people at your matter, your discussion. Because I think the maieutica is so important, and you know better than me, that it's very important to grow up. My knowledge is specific, but is limited. And then I need to grow up more and more and more. And when I talk with people they have more experience than me, maybe in communication or in business, for instance, but it's not my matter, it's not my field. There is also a sort of exchange, you know? I can give them some secret of my job, and they give me different secret that I never used in my workshop. Then it is all time is a discovering new level and new layer of this work. The magic thing is that no communication with the body is very open. It's very open. You can start to discuss this about university language or communication, business, industry, whatever, and educational for school and wherever in relationship between couples. So important that the communication, right? Yeah. And I'm working with psychologists about that. And it's so interesting, even with children with some issues in learn, okay? They use autism, for instance, they use a lot of body language, and then you can connect with them in the best way, more than words. And you know what I mean? Then it's different. Every day I find a new way to discuss about this field. And this is fantastic because it's like infinity.
That the interesting thing is how you transform your niche into a platform which has a million applications. In this sense, the ability to connect it into a dialogue with many other different disciplines through the social multitasking media is a way to switch the platform and to make it really a piazza where many people can interact. So when you create value, many people can join and enrich the value, not just enjoy it. So
it depends how you look even at your work. If you think I'm a movie director and stop, I can stop just after my movie about Italian gesture, finish. But if you are looking to you and your work in a fluently way, like fluid, and this is my personal approach in life, it's fluid, open and fluid. Every input could change my path, but always, connected with the past. Then is not just another thing completely different. It's always like in the same
random novelty. That
exactly. Yeah. And I love it. I'm surfing in these different layers. I love it.
No, in this word fluidity that you use, so the ability to connect a heritage, a tradition, to a livelihood of the present, something that is not just a depository of past or folklore, but really something
that
taps into the vitalism that creates something new, that creates a new gesture. Now, you mentioned like your work as a movie director, which is, of course, one of the main pieces of your activity. And in as a director in your documentaries, you investigated among many such issues as the Italian red zones, the Sicilian gestures, the island of Lampedusa, Italian emigration to London, which is kind of the biggest Italian emigration in the present.
Right.
What led you to these themes? Why did you choose them?
Usually the themes appear in my mind like naturally. And I think personally we are all migrants. Then migration was very, very important in my life. I'm migrant too, and
I'm migrant as well.
So I know, and I think if you look the world like a place with a lot of migrants from all over the world, because we are citizens of this world, this planet, but the land is not our land, but it's a land. In this way, I think it's so important to discuss about different, you know, side of the discussion of migrants. And before Influx, there was about Italians in London. I did another documentary about Italians in Belgium to work in the coal mines after the Second World War. And it was very, very different migration, but with something very, you know, similar to the new migration. Then it's like a different step of migrants, of Italians around the world. And I think it's so interesting for me because Lampedusa is the opposite side. We are the host of the migrants from the south, right? And then to me, it was too close, just a circle of storytelling about migrations. Honestly, all times I have different idea and something coming up, like a genial idea. I go, oh, I want to tell this. And it's never like too much studied before, like a strategy or commercial strategy, never. Always from my heart and my stomach. And, you know, then it's very instinctive, more emotional than rational.
Now, in your documentaries, I want to point out like a couple of phrases that really struck me. Now, first, in dealing with the pandemic, you stress that the so-called return to normality will not be a return, but rather, and you say, the beginning of a new journey with a different awareness. And also in dealing with the new life of many Italians in London, focal point of the documentary is a phrase that you catch from one of your interviewees that says, to begin is our only way to be. And this made me remember a famous phrase by the Italian writer Cesare Pavese, which says like, to live is to begin always at every instant.
Right.
What do you begin every time you start a new workshop or a new film? What does the creative gesture bring to you? Where does it start?
I'm thinking something related to my mom, just because I think my mom is my guru of creativity and also of my emotional intelligence. And because just to tell you an anecdote, she started to cook, opening the fridge, and there start the creativity without a project. What I want to cook? I don't know. Open the fridge. I have this. Okay, how I can combine in the best way or mix this food to create something beautiful, amazing, and tasty? And she start to cook. This kind of approach in life was mine. I really love improvisation. I'm really good in this. And all time people call me like in a conference or in places just without any preparation. And they ask me, okay, let's improvise something about this subject that we discussed today. And I start, only start. And I think in my mind, of course, improvisation is not just telling shit, bullshit. You know what I mean? Like it's something that is a skill, that maybe I have naturally in myself. And the creativity to me means when I have a lot of goosebumps thinking something special, I realize that it's the time to start this project or this idea. And the creativity to me is when I start to be in the flow, completely immersive in the flow, I can't think about timing, places, people around me. I'm in the flow. And when I'm in the flow, I'm so creative. Mm-hmm. I can write like one night, all night, one day, or just playing or just filming or whatever. But doing this, I'm feeling like the joy. I mean, the best joy in my life. That's why I'm back a child, like a child that played with the best game in his life. You know what I mean? And that's why I love my job, because my job is my life. My life is my job. It's a joke, it's a play, a game. I'm playing the best game in my life. And that's why it's not difficult. It's okay, it's very hard work, no stop, all time, blah, blah, blah. Yes, I love it, Luca. I can stop. And this
goes back also to what you were saying at the beginning, really the discovery of the path as you walk, because you are in a flow that allows you to really grow. And this is actually the core of the entrepreneurial experience. The effort and the joy of growing something.
And of course, the determination to continue, you know, without any distraction. Okay, yes, but I want to go there.
There is no adventure without the discipline to really walk it. There is a risk, but there is also a discipline in dealing with that.
Exactly.
Risk, with that path.
And maybe, Luca, this is the only discipline I have in my life. It's the only one in heart when I do job.
No, but like, and when that's you say, it. Like the improvisation element, improvisation is not something you make up. It's something that requires a lot of effort, involvement, the ability to develop, and this is part of also your workshops, to play with events, to be at ease in a context where you're outside your comfort zone, and right. And really play with it and mix elements and see different elements, not as an obstacle or a difficulty, but rather the ingredients, as you were saying, of a new recipe that might become the next big thing.
And also you open another point, so important. I love challenge. Even when I think it's so difficult to do the job or the project or whatever, this is exactly what's, you know, push me to start. It's very difficult. Okay, I like it. It's impossible. Yes. Okay, I want to do it. And that's never stopped me, like the difficulties, the difficulties and whatever. But I love the challenge then to risk.
This is also the core, again, of the entrepreneurial mindset, like which starts from an attraction. From something that catches our
fatal
attention.
Fatal attraction sometimes.
Yeah. And that makes us busy in the sense that, like, business is not just a commercial.
Exactly.
Business is a condition. We are busy trying to chase that element of attraction that requires our commitment, our involvement, our discipline, our path, our risk, our willingness to follow wherever the road leads. With this creativity, this with this, at the same time, and this ability to connect elements, which exactly. is really the work of an intellectual interledger, reading through and connecting the dots. So it's the conversation. We talked a lot about other things, about the body. We started from the body as a language. About gestures as a natural form of expression. We talked about the Italian patrimony of gestures as a rich platform, really, to develop new forms of effective communication across different media, of course, and different markets. So it was really a pleasure having this conversation. I hope it was inspiring to many. So
I hope too. And Luca, thank you so much for this time together and this conversation.
And thanks everybody for watching, and I invite you to subscribe to this channel or to the newsletter on the webpage of the show at www.italianinnovators.com to receive notifications of new episodes and know more about the project. You can also follow me on my LinkedIn profile or Instagram at Italian Innovators. And you can also follow Luca Vullo on Instagram and LinkedIn. You can find there my page, like updates, news, and additional material, additional contents on the show. Thanks, everybody, for your support.
Thank you to all of you. Ciao.
Arrivederci. Alla prossima.